after you finish reading, start copying 706. Please write fast. Done, Nanaran, done. Okay, pay attention. Please write fast. Black magic. Okay. I hope you have finished copying. Who is talking? Okay. Now, just pay attention properly. Emphasis of matters paragraph and other matters paragraph. Now, see what happens. I just showed you the format of audit report, that first an auditor has to give his opinion, then he has to give a basis of modification para if he is modifying his opinion. You already know what is modifying opinion: giving a qualified opinion, giving an adverse opinion, or giving a disclaimer of opinion. This is modified opinion. Now, below this modification para, two more paragraphs he can give. Okay, two more paragraphs he can give. One is the EOM para, and the second one is the OM para. EOM stands for emphasis of matters. Okay, let's read it out. EOM stands for emphasis of matters. So when I say emphasis of matters para, it is given below the opinion para. Okay, it is given below the opinion para. And when I say other matters para, it is given even below the emphasis of matters para. So other matters para will be after the opinion and emphasis of matters para, whereas emphasis of matters para will be just below the opinion para. Now, why we are studying this standard, what is the logic, and how, you know, to write this answer is very important to understand. So first and foremost thing, why this standard was introduced? Why this standard was introduced? See, basically, auditor wants to communicate so many things to the stakeholders. Who are the stakeholders in the company? Who are the stakeholders? Only shareholders are the stakeholders. I would say in a company, a stakeholder can be a shareholder. A stakeholder can be a creditor also, very good. A stakeholder can be a debtor. A stakeholder can be a lawyer also in the company. Anybody, you know, banker in the company can be a stakeholder. Government can be, very good answer. Government can be a stakeholder. So what I'm trying to tell you, anybody who is interested in the company, when I'll tell you to clap, you clap, okay? So anybody who is interested in the company is the stakeholder of the company, or anybody who has some claims in the company is the stakeholder of the company. So what it implies here, that when an auditor wants to communicate something extra, something additional to the stakeholders, now he can do so with the emphasis of matters para and other matters para. I will give you the importance why we are studying these two paragraphs in the audit reports. Okay, just one example I want to tell you. See, actually this example is meant for CA final level, but then I can understand that you are also intelligent enough, so I can give you this example. So how this example actually works? Suppose today any Indian company, say company A. Company A is a company which is listed on a stock exchange in India. When I say on a stock exchange in India, I will call it as a recognized stock exchange. Okay. So suppose if company A is listed on a recognized stock exchange in India, company A feels that I should go overseas also, not only in India. So suppose this stock exchange is there in India, company feels that I should also go to America for raising some funds from America. Okay. Now in India, all the stock exchanges are monitored by SEBI. What is SEBI? Securities and Exchange Board of India. SEBI is a regulator for all the stock exchanges in India. That means if there is any fraud taking place, SEBI will give the punishment to the fraudster. Likewise, if a company goes abroad, say for example in America, then in America, the stock exchange regulator is the SEC. Now, sir, what is this SEC? SEC stands for Securities Exchange Commission. It is just like SEBI only, exactly same as SEBI only. In fact, it is much more powerful than SEBI. The name of this authority is the Securities Exchange Commission. So what work SEBI does in India, SEC, that same work SEC does in America and all the countries across, you know, the America, Asia and Europe. Okay. So SEC is a very, very powerful regulator, just like SEBI, how SEBI works in India. Now, there is one requirement of SEC, that if an Indian company wants to come into America for raising the funds or, you know, issuing shares in America, SEC says that you have to prepare your Indian financial statements. See, in India, there is something called as the Ind GAAPs. Have you heard this word GAAPs? What do you mean by GAAPs? generally accepted accounting practices. So when you are in India, you have to follow the Indian GAAPs for preparing your financial statements. In short, you have to follow your Indian accounting standards for preparing financial statement. But that does not work when you are in America. When you go to America, American laws say that you have to follow US GAAPs. What you have to follow there? US GAAPs, United States GAAPs, okay? So now suppose if an Indian company has not made the financial statements in the US GAAP format, the SEC will not give the permission to the Indian company for listing, okay? That means if you want the listing permission, first you will have to prepare your financial statements as per the US GAAP. That means what? When you're following US GAAP, please try to understand, you will have to appoint a certified public accountant. See, in India, the auditor can be a CA, but in America, we call that person as what? A CPA, a certified public accountant. So when an Indian company is trying to follow US GAAPs, suppose I'll give you an instance here. I've seen the balance sheet of Tata and Sons, very big company, and Tata and Sons have already started following US GAAPs. You know, it is not even listed. It is not even listed in America as far as the American laws are concerned, yet it has started to follow the US GAAPs. Now, when I say Tata and Sons, though it is not listed, why it is following US GAAP? What is the reason for following US GAAP? The answer is very simple. It wants to get itself, you know, used to following US GAAP. So when the time for listing will come, that will not be a new thing for Tata and Sons to start following US GAAP, because it already is following from some number of years. That means my emphasis here is that I want to tell you that when a company tries to apply some policies or accounting standards at a very, very earlier stage, even before they are applicable to the company. So today Tata and Sons is not raising money from abroad. Tata and Sons is raising money from Indian stock exchanges only. But tomorrow when Tata and Sons will go to America, it does not have to call for a CPA and wait till the Indian accounts are converted into US GAAP, because it is already used to the habit of preparing the Indian accounts in the US GAAP format also. So now Tata and Sons, what is Tata and Sons is doing? It is doing earlier application of accounting policy. Such type of data is called as what? Earlier application of accounting policy. Now somebody will say that, sir, if I start following a policy before it is applicable to me, is it a correct thing? I would say answer is yes. Okay, yes, answer is yes. See, you are not contravening to the accounting policies. Please understand, what do you mean by contravention? Not following, you're breaking the law. Okay, you're violating the law. You're not violating the law here. In fact, what law you're going to follow in future when it will become applicable to you, you have just started following. It does not mean that you're not following the Indian laws. Tata is of course making the balance sheet in the Ind GAAP format also, but it is also making its balance sheet in the US GAAP format also. And do you know that the Indian ROC, the Indian Registrar of Company, will readily accept both the balance sheet. He will never say no to the US GAAP balance sheet. Have you understood this point? So what did Tata do? It is doing early application of accounting policy. But see, this thing, Tata knows that it is going to come out with a share issue in America. This thing, the auditor of Tata knows that Tata is going to come out with a share issue in America. But the shareholder is a layman person for Tata. Okay, shareholder has just come, he has just invested his money. So if I want to additionally speak something with the shareholder, then I can do so. Then I can do so by introducing a new paragraph in my audit report. And such new paragraph will be called as what? Emphasis of matters para. What do you mean by the term emphasis of matters? Look at the term emphasis. Emphasis means to put some more attention, to draw, to highlight some point to the shareholder. So when I want to communicate something extra by highlighting that point to the shareholder, I will try to emphasize on that point, or I will try to emphasize on that point. That is why auditors give this new paragraph. So whenever you do anything new in the financial statement, okay, this example is normally an example which very, very, you know, high profile level people speak on this example, but then I will make sure that I give you simple IPCC examples also. So if you look at the simple example which are there in the study material, like if the concept of going concern is affected, and then is one financial reason because of which the going concern assumption gets affected. Are we have done one standard on going concern, you can easily tell me 2-3 financial reasons why going concern assumption can get affected. negative earning per share, negative net worth, negative dividend, more debt, less equity, high leverage, high financial leverage. All these reasons we have already done in classroom. So when I say that I'm talking about going concern assumption being affected, and it is because of the financial reason, you must emphasize that reason in a separate paragraph, as I've shown here. Look here. How will you emphasize? Below this para, now you'll give one more para here. You will justify that the going concern assumption is being affected, because of which I'm writing the reason here. So as an auditor, you have to justify that reason. If the management changes its accounting policies significantly, now somebody had an argument here that, sir, if the management changes in accounting policies, it discloses in the notes to accounts. When you change your accounting policy as a management, as a preparer of financial statement, you have to make a disclosure in notes to accounts. But I am saying that even though management is changing in its accounting policies, let the management disclose, but you as an auditor should also disclose such changes in your audit report. So you are doing your job, let the management do its own job. So now auditors are also required to make a disclosure of significant changes in accounting policies in their audit report. But where will they disclose? They should have a place to disclose. So now Institute of Chartered Accountants of India says that you can disclose such things in the emphasis of matters para. You are given the liberty of a free space where you can incorporate such changes. So let us read it out now. When an auditor has to draw attention, see, my job as an auditor is to make sure that I'm communicating each and everything to the shareholder, okay, to the stakeholders. That means what? I'm talking about something called as transparency. You understand what's transparency? Being clear with the shareholder, talking to the point with the shareholder, communicating each and everything to the shareholder. So when an auditor has to draw the attention of stakeholders for a better understanding of financial statements and audit reports, see, when the shareholder will come to know that, okay, the Tata company is coming out with a issue in America, the shareholder itself will be very happy. In fact, he will start investing more money in the company because he knows that he is also going to get some capital appreciation in the form of shares, you know, capital gains. That is why, because see, when you introduce your shares in a new country altogether, of course the prices of the Indian shares are going to go high because of the bullish market trend. Okay, people will be positive on your company, their sentiments will be more attached to the company, etc. So I need to draw the attention of stakeholders on this aspect, but that is why I'm introducing this paragraph in the audit report. Then he may also introduce two new paragraphs. There are two new paragraphs. One is the emphasis of matters para, second one is the other matters para. And when I'm doing this, when I have to draw the attention of the stakeholders, what do you mean by emphasis of matters para? You can in IPCC 100% get this for a short note. Very important, 4 marks short note can come, emphasis of matters para. How this works? When an auditor wants to communicate by laying emphasis, emphasis means what? You want to highlight certain matter, okay, on the which is a financial matter. Of course, let me honestly tell you that whenever you're writing something in the emphasis of matters para, please make sure that the matter which you're writing is a financial matter. So by something which is a financial matter, he will incorporate emphasis of matters para in his audit report. That means if you want to communicate something to the stakeholder and which is a financial thing you want to communicate, you will do so by giving emphasis of matters para. For instance, what? The concept of going concern is affected. Or for instance, if there is a significant change in the accounting policy. It is not necessary that an auditor has to qualify his audit report. Very important point this is. See, some people say that, sir, auditor is giving emphasis of matters because he is qualifying his opinion. Just now I taught you something called as qualified opinion. If he is qualifying his opinion, then he will give the reason in the modification para. Why will he use the emphasis of matters para? So when an auditor is giving a qualified report, still he can use the emphasis of matter. When an auditor is giving an unqualified opinion, a clean opinion, still he may use the emphasis of matter. So emphasis of matter has nothing to do whether it is qualified or whether it is not qualified. Have you understood this point? So it is not necessary that an auditor has to qualify his audit report for, you know, giving emphasis of matters para. So emphasis of matters para is totally a mutually exclusive condition. What do you mean by mutually exclusive? It is not dependent on qualification. It is not dependent on qualification at all. If you are qualifying, still you will have EOM. If you are not qualifying, yet you will have EOM. Have you understood this point? I am honestly telling you, the way you are learning here and simple way of writing it, if you read your module and practice manual, you will never follow what is written. So please pay attention, okay? Nobody will try to talk anything. What is emphasis? Is it mutually exclusive or not? Yes. Yes, of course it's mutually. Is it dependent on qualification? Not at all, not at all. Let me tell you something on the other matters para. They may ask you a distinction between also. Distinction between an emphasis of matters versus other matters para in your IBCC paper. What is this other matters paragraph? Now see, if an auditor, why I'm writing, making you write this point, if an auditor is doing some extra work in the company, see, auditors also should get some credit for the work they do, or at least they should disclose to the shareholders what extra work they have done apart from auditing. Anything which is associated with auditing, the statutory auditor will always write here in the opinion para. This paragraph is only for the statutory auditor. Please let me tell you, all the standards which we are studying are only for the statutory auditors. The internal auditors never give any opinion as far as the financial statements are concerned. So we are strictly talking about the statutory auditors only. So if an auditor has checked financial statements and if he wants to say that the financial statements are true and fair, that he will say in this paragraph, opinion para. But after checking financial statement, if the management asks the auditor to do some additional work or to have some additional responsibility, there is no provision here that he can write something. Okay, so now ICAI says that let an auditor get the provision somewhere here in the corner, which is the other matters para. What is this other matters para? An other matters para is given when an auditor is doing some extra work. Remember this plus sign, some extra work he is doing. So when he is doing something additional or extra work, he should know that he should get the credit for that work, and secondly, he should also inform that work to the stakeholders. So when I'm reading this point, please pay attention. If an auditor performs additional duties or responsibilities, then he can mention such matters in the other matters para. Let me tell you that the matters which I'm talking here have nothing to do with financial statements. They are totally non-financial in nature. Okay, they're totally non-financial in nature. Suppose I was appointed as the statutory auditor of X Limited and the company also told me that, sir, you are working in the head office, one day can you go to the branch and see what work is going on in the branch? I said no problem, but when I did this extra work for the company, for which the company may even give me extra remuneration, but I should communicate this point to the shareholder that what additional things I am doing in the company apart from doing my normal statutory audit work. So like if I visited branches, I can write there. Company told me that, sir, if you're doing audit, can you do a 100% stock audit? Now, what do you mean by stock audit? See, now many companies are finalizing their accounts after 31st March gets over. So this period, the May, June, July, August period is basically the finalization period going on. Next year, if you're doing your articleship, you will be that time working and finalizing some balance sheet only, just next year coming. Okay, so when you are visiting the factory for doing specially stock audit over and above the statutory audit, this is something extra you have done for the management, you can of course write that you have done stock audit, and this you can write in the other matters para. Have you understood this point? These examples which I am giving you are IMP because they may frame a case study also. Auditor was told to go and visit the factory, then he was told to do verification of stock. How will you as an auditor deal with such situation? So you should say that as an auditor, I would incorporate this matter in the other matters para, and you have to write the reason for that. And you should also tell to the examiner that the EOM para is placed before the opinion para. It is below the opinion para, and the other matters para is placed below the EOM para. Okay, so that place also you should tell this to the examiner. You know, many chartered accountants also don't know this point, what you are studying, because they have passed and then these standards have come. So if they are not upgraded with the new standards, even they won't know that they have to write something. So after 2-3 years, when you join, suppose next year if you do your articleship, you can tell to a person that, sir, what you have done is now upgraded to the next level. Now you have to also incorporate other emphasis of matters para and other matters para. That is how you can increase your stipend. You understood what I'm trying to say? So EOM matters para is placed below the opinion para, and then this para is placed after the EOM para. Have you understood this point? Yeah, please read it. The standard is done.